even to co-workers and casual acquaintances. Leith frequently had remarked that he would be happy when both of Bonnie's children were grown and gone. And as the summer of 1988 approached, that time seemed imminent. By fall, Angela would be in college in Greensboro, and if Chris didn't flunk out, which seemed highly possible, he would be back at NC State for his sophomore year. Leith and Bonnie would be alone, and Leith soon would be quitting the job he never had liked. Leith should have been excited by the prospect, but to his old friend Rob Lorber, he seemed resigned, as if he sensed that life had passed him by. 6. While Bradford Tedderton was calling frantically for the rescue squad, Danny Edwards began trying the other upstairs doors, still uncertain whether an intruder was hiding behind one of them. He opened one door, shined his flashlight inside, and saw a form lying in bed. He switched on the light to see a scene of teenage disorder. Clothes were strewn. The walls were covered with posters of rock stars, horses, a frosty mug of beer, a string of Budweiser longnecks, shoes, socks. A hairdryer lay on the floor by a rug that had horse country on it. A big square fan hummed, blowing directly on a young woman with short, light brown hair and freckles, sleeping soundly in a t-shirt. "Ma'am?" "Ma'am," Edwards called. The young woman stirred and sat up abruptly, frightened. "What is it?" Edwards recognized her, although he didn't remember her name. Before he'd joined the police department, he'd been security chief at the mall, and he remembered seeing her many times with the other teenagers who regularly gathered there.